County Board of Education meeting of February 23rd, 2015 will please come to order. I want to welcome everyone to our meeting at Central High School, and I want to thank all of our colleagues and friends at Central for hosting this evening's meeting. It's a really wonderful chance to be here. We begin the afternoon with a tour of the facilities here at about 3:15. We then had work sessions at 4 and 5:30, the first one on Head Start and other early child education activities, and then at 5:30 we had a work session on the superintendent's contract. So it is now my pleasure to ask us to take our traditional moment of silence. Thank you. Okay, thank you. It's now my pleasure to ask District 1 elementary students to come forward and lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. So if we would all stand, please. Next, we're going to ask some students from our ESL Newcomer Academy to come forward to read our vision statement.
Hi everyone, my name is Ahmed, I'm from Somalia. Tonight I want to say JCBS vision statement. So all JCBS students graduate prepared to reach their full potential and contribute to our society throughout our life.
Hi everyone, my name is Nasra, I'm from Somalia. Today I wanted to say GCB vision statement in Somali. The man GCBS did the way I go and Chibia, why did the Arian say you got on why I see Buddha, whether the Karanika cover Sida no in the
Hello, my name is Ibrahim. I'm from Iraq. I speak Arabic. I will talk about GCBS. جميع الطلاب في JCBS يتخرجون استعدادا للوصول الى كامل امكانياتهم المساهمه في مجتمعهم في جميع مراحل الحياه. Thank you.
Hello everyone, good evening. My name is Jeremy Daniel Perez and my native language, I'm from Philippines and my native language is Filipino. I'll be saying it in Tagalog. Lahat ng JCPS mag-aaral magtapos handa upang maabot ang kanilang buong potensyal at mag-ambag ating lipunan sa buong buhay. Thank you.
Thank you. I want to thank our students and just tell them how blessed we are that they have chosen and their families have chosen to live in Louisville, Kentucky. We're delighted to have you here with us this evening, and that is a great start to the meeting. It's now my pleasure to introduce Vice Chair Diane Porter, who is also the board member from District 1, and let her take over to run the procedures for a little while.
Thank you, Chair Jones, and welcome to Central High School, which I call the historic Central High School for lots of reasons. I am very excited that you're here tonight. I'm very excited that we had school today. Parents are excited that they had school today. I saw lots of smiles at dinner time, so let's give that a big hand clap. We are happy to be back in school today. I am so honored that you have chosen Central High School as the location for this particular board meeting in District 1. This is our second effort to go out to the community, and at our dinner, we had an opportunity to hear a presentation from the students from Carter Traditional Elementary School, so we could give them a round of applause because they were awesome. In order for us to move forward in time, we have to look back at our history, and it's really important to me to say that I am honored to be at Central High School. I am honored to say that my mother graduated from Central High School and my uncles graduated from Central High School. I have a book that my uncle had that was autographed by his principal, Atwood Wilson, and in the verse that he left for my uncle, he said, "Robert, never give up." So I say to our students, never give up. At this time, I would like to honor any graduates from Central High School. So would you please stand so we can give you a round of applause if you graduated from Central High School? Thank you so much. Thank you for being here tonight. At this time, I would like to recognize the staff from District 1 who you're just awesome, wonderful every day. So if you work in District 1, please stand up so we can give you a round of applause. All the staff members. District 1, I think the last time I counted, I had 21 elementary schools, 5 middle schools, and 4 high schools, and I have wonderful programs like the ESL program. So there's lots of wonderful activity that happens every day for the students of Jefferson County in District 1. I'm very proud of that, and I cannot say that enough. I know that we work hard every day. I thank you for being here. I thank the students for being here. You're going to meet some wonderful students in a little bit, but at this time I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Dan Withers, who is in fact the principal of this wonderful historic high school, and he's going to give you a little bit of information, and then you're going to hear from some students from the Magnet. So Dr. Withers, before I turn it over to you, let me say to you, I know I have been a pest, and as my colleague would say, I've been in the weeds, because it was real important that this was the best meeting that we could have for everybody. So thank you to you and your staff and everyone that has worked very hard to welcome us to Central High School. Dr. Dan Withers.
If you don't mind, I'll take the mic out and just kind of face everybody, see if I can face everybody. But I'd like to thank the board members, Mr. Jones, Ms. Diane Porter, Dr. Hargens, and everybody for choosing Central as to highlight Central High School. I appreciate you being here. I'm also a proud graduate of Central High School, graduated in 1964. I guess that means I've been around a long, long time, but it's getting close to the end at this point. But at any rate, I was asked to give a little bit of history of Central High School, and Central has a long, rich history. But I won't go way back to 1882 when Central was started, but I will talk about the magnet programs. The first magnet program that we had was in 1986. And that was a law and government magnet. And then in 1991, we phased in the other 9 magnets. Now we're unique in Jefferson County in that we're a totally magnet school. Every student at Central High School has to declare a magnet by the end of their freshman year. No other school has that type of program. They got themes that they talk about, but we are a comprehensive magnet. When kids leave out of here, in many cases, they're employable. For example, the nursing students have the CNA normally when they leave here, and they can work their way through college. We have partnerships with each of our magnets. Now, I'll just give you a list, quick list of the magnets. We have four medical magnets. We have pre-med students who would like to be doctors someday. We have a nursing magnet. We have a dental magnet. We have a veterinary science magnet. By the way, we do shampoo. We check animals for heartworms. So if you have an animal, a dog, and want them groomed, you can bring them back here. I think it's on Wednesdays or Thursdays. Just kidding. Fridays. I forget. Getting old. But at any rate, we also have three business magnets. We have business management, we have marketing and entrepreneurship, and we have a banking magnet. We also have a computer technology magnet, and we have a law and government law and government magnet. Now, when I finish here, we'll let our students from each magnet come up and tell you a little bit about their magnet. Now, in their freshman year, each student will rotate for 3 weeks through each magnet. And that's to give them an opportunity to determine which magnet they want to go into in their sophomore year. And then when they become sophomores, they're in that magnet for 3 years, sophomore through junior year. So they do get a comprehensive course in whatever their magnet area is. When I first came here in 1993 as an assistant principal, I really didn't know the importance of having a magnet program because I was more of a traditional teacher or an administrator at that point. And shortly after I got here, and my predecessor kept telling me, though magnets are important, and what I found it does quickly is that it gives kids a focus. It gives them a reason for learning. Learning in the academic areas. For example, if a child wants to be a lawyer, then what becomes very important for them? Language, being able to speak well, being able to write well, because lawyers have to do those things. If they want to be a nurse or a doctor or a dentist, then their science classes become critically important for them. Anatomy, physiology, biology, chemistry. If a kid really decides, this is what I want to be, this is what my vocation is going to be, when then those classes become critically important to them and they do better in those classes. Now they have a focus for doing well in an academic class. We know we're not turning out a lawyer at the end of their senior year or a doctor or even a nurse, but at least it pushes them on to the next level. They know what they have to do in order to get there. Another thing that it does for us is that when we partner with a law office or the courts or partner with U of L in terms of the law and government magnet or the dental magnet, those folks come in and tell us what we need to do to prepare our students to go to the next step. So we have partners who actually kind of guide us through it and let us know what students need to do to be better students to go on to the college level. So these are the things that we do here at Central High School to try to prepare our kids to go to the next level. But at this time, I will turn it over to my students. Why don't you come up? And each of my students is going to tell you a little bit about their magnet program. Can you come up? Thank you.
Hello, my name is Epiphany Clarkson, and I'm a senior in the pre-med magnet. This year, we are currently learning about EKG, which is electrocardiogram. We learn about the anatomy of the heart, how to read EKGs, how to properly place leads on patients, how to attend to a patient properly when you're doing an EKG on them, and we're learning about myocardial ischemia and infarctions, which are medical terms for strokes and heart attacks. The EKG certification test will be taken in a week, and EKG will help me in my future because I want to be a neurologist. But I feel like that any field you go into as a doctor, you should know the basic study of the heart because you never know what happens. You could be in an emergency at any time, and you could be the only doctor around. And now I am recently hired at St. Mary's and Jewish Hospital.
My name is Dallas Simpson. I'm president of our FBLA chapter and a proud member of our Fifth Third Bank and Finance Magnet. We are currently learning basically just money management. Over the course of the 3 years that I've been here prior to my senior year, we've learned so much involving money management, but we've mainly focused on business as a whole. So this year, the reason why I feel like this is the most important year for me is because money management carries out throughout your whole life. And it's something that is very vital in having a successful career and obtaining wealth. And that's why I feel like this school is the school for me, because it gives me a good basis for life now, later, and for the rest of my life. Thank you.
Hello, good evening. My name is Kendall Briggs. I'm currently a junior, and I am currently in the computer technology magnet. We are learning about the techniques on the help desk and the hands-on ways of fixing and repairing computers. And I feel like that the techniques I've learned with this career choice magnet is very beneficial to my future because of understanding the way technology works and breaking down the facts and the importance of it. Thank you.
My name is Nakia Johnson. I'm in the senior in the marketing magnet. And this year we are currently in our, we're learning about our entrepreneurship section of our curriculum. So we're learning about things such as layout, design, and distribution. And actually this year we ran a successful business through the JA program. We sold portable chargers to the Central High School family. I was elected president of that company. So, and we also but we participate in things such as the 4-H APES program, and that's held at the convention center downtown. And we partner with Mercer, which is the building with the big dome on the top, and we learn about how they run their business and stuff like that, because they do theirs through surveys. And I think it's helped me in my future because not only will it prepare me for college, but it'll prepare me for the real world because of the conversations we have. We talk about things not only globally, but internationally, and we just, our class is very small, so we kind of intertwine and we all connect as one.
My name is Michael Brown. I'm a senior in the Law and Government Magnet. I'm a Carl Wedekind Scholar at the American Civil Liberties Union. I am currently taking a dual credit class at University of Louisville, Introduction to Paralegal Studies. We are going over torts, contracts, civil cases. We will do a research paper in about 2 weeks or so. And I feel like that this will impact my future because you gotta know your rights as a citizen, and law is a big part of your life every day. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Leticia Robinson, and I am a senior in the Business Management Magnet. The past 2 years, we have basically learned the core values of becoming an entrepreneur, which include financing, marketing, advertising, and business management. This year, we actually run a store after school from 2:20 to 2:45, and it's like a convenience store. We sell after school snacks and stuff, and the profit that we make from the store goes towards scholarships. I feel like my magnet will help me in the future because I would like to become an entrepreneur someday.
Hello, my name is Madison Mays, and I'm a junior, and I'm in the Veterinary Science Magnet. My magnet is great for me because I feel like it teaches me all the things that I need to help me get a head start in college. For example, this year we've learned about veterinary restraint for all the animals that'll come through a clinic's doors, such as dogs, cats, livestock, and so on. Most recently, we've learned about dog vaccinations and why we do them, and one of the biggest parts of the dog vaccinations we've learned is the acronym DHLPPC in rabies. And what this stands for is distemper, hepatitis, leptospirosis, parainfluenza, parvo, corona, and rabies. And we learn all the ins and outs about it. And the veterinary magnet is also an active member in HOSA, which is an organization that is designed to help teach students about the healthcare profession. And I myself am the president of HOSA at Central, and I have participated in the local competitions, and in March I plan on participating in state competitions.
Hello, my name is Brianna Jones. I'm a senior and a senior class representative at Central High School. I'm in the nursing magnet. And currently this year in the nursing class, we are working on patients. We are working on how to take care of them adequately, how to provide patient privacy, and how to care for them as far as giving them baths and just everyday things that they can do for themselves. We're currently learning how to take vital signs, such as blood pressure, manually and with the blood pressure cuff, how to take pulse rates, and also heart rates. This will help me in the long run because I plan to go to University of Louisville and major in nursing, and I'll have my CNA certificate by the end of this school year, and it'll help me because I can get a career in nursing in a hospital or a nursing home, and trying to get through college is tough, and I could pay for it that way. So it'll help me. And in the end, I want to become a nurse anesthetist. I'll be working with anesthesiologists, and this will get my foot in the door.
Hello, my name is Kobe Atkinson. I'm a senior in the dental magnet. Currently in the dental magnet, we are working towards our radiation certification while learning the skills and trades of a dental assistant. I've also received other certifications such as CPR and first aid, and I also have my OSHA bloodborne pathogen certification. I believe that the education I received this year along with the past 2 years will allow me to graduate from Central and be able to step directly into the workforce as a dental assistant while continuing my education at the University of Louisville to become a dentist. Thank you.
I just want to make mention that when you come in the front door, if you look to the right in that front lobby, you'll see plaques on the wall. Those are distinguished graduates of Central High School. If you look at them and examine them, I'm sure that you will recognize a lot of those people who have made some contribution other than athletics to society here in Louisville, or actually nationally. By the way, we're starting another distinguished alumni magnet just for the law students. We have 30 lawyers, we have 30 people practicing law now who graduated from Central High School. 28 of them graduated since the magnet programs were started here at Central High School. So we're very proud of that fact. So this year we're starting a law and government distinguished alumni, distinguished alumni program for those people who are now practicing law. At this time, will all the students come back up because we want to take a picture, please?
If you all will please take the stage, Board Vice Chair Porter, if you will join the students and Principal Dr. Dan Withers and Ms. Cynthia Eddings King, will you please join them as well?
Okay, thank you so much, students, Principal Withers. We're delighted to have had an opportunity to hear from you. It is now my pleasure to introduce Ms. Terry Robinson for the recognitions and resolutions section of the meeting.
Thank you, Dr. Hargens, Board Chair David Jones Jr., and members of the Jefferson County Board of Education. We begin with the recognition of the Mazeek Middle School student team of Mark Raj, Anjali Chada, Adidita Mehta, Jacob Ioff, and Allison Tu, who were selected as a Best in Nation winner in the National Verizon Innovation App Challenge. The competition provides an opportunity for middle and high school students to apply their science, technology, engineering, and math knowledge, skills, and creativity to develop an original mobile app concept that incorporates the use of STEM and addresses a need or problem in their school or community. At this time, I would like to ask Mr. Chris Berber, principal, to come forward to make some brief remarks about these outstanding students.
Good evening, Dr. Hargens, Board Chair, Mr. Jones, District 1 Representative Ms. Porter, and members of the Board of Education. Thank you for the opportunity to join you tonight as you recognize these five outstanding Mazeek students and leaders. I couldn't be more proud of the young people who will be joining you on the stage momentarily as national winners in the Verizon Innovative App Challenge. I'm sure many in our community have been stunned that eighth graders, one of whom is only 12 years old, and only one of whom has reached the wise old age of 14, from Louisville, Kentucky, have achieved such national success on the national stage. But to those of us who know these young people, an achievement like this is no surprise. This group of students excels in the classroom, all maintaining a 4.0 grade point average, which includes an accelerated math class combining Algebra 2 and geometry concepts, as well as countless hours in after-school activities. Members of various academic teams, such as Math Counts, Science Olympiad, and Quick Recall and Written Assessment. Clearly, these students are passionate about science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Tonight, while we celebrate these five individuals, I would love for all of you to know that at Mazeek Middle School, our halls are bursting with students who share these same passions. At the school where the world comes to learn, we see every day the power of innovative thinking coupled with good old-fashioned hard work and determination. Have faith that this generation of blossoming scientists, programmers, engineers, and mathematicians are preparing to set the world on fire, much like their peers representing our school tonight. Now, we know that successful schools run on lots of engines, and all of those engines have to be working at full capacity and firing in tune with one another. I would like to recognize and thank the power behind our innovative thinkers, teachers, and parents who combined efforts to make sure students came back after our best in state win last year to take best in nation this year. I'd like to express my gratitude to Mr. Tim Baker for his teacher leadership and constant willingness to step up the plate to support our school. Mr. Baker is one of those teachers who comes with the building. If the doors are open, he's there. And to parent Ms. Vidya Ravichandran, thank you for being our eyes and ears in the field, always looking for ways to support and enrich our entire student body. Ms. Ravichandran is so busy contributing to our school, I'm convinced that she doesn't sleep. There must be an app for that, and I want it. It is a joy to have such successful young people among the student body at Mazeek. That joy will continue as we marvel in the successes that are sure to follow them. The faculty and staff at Mazeek, and I know the entire JCPS community, will be proud to call each of them one of our own for years to come. I would like to ask them to join me on the stage at this time for a picture.
Next, we have the honor of introducing to you our distinguished middle and high school principals in District 1, who will highlight and introduce an exemplary student in their school. First, I'd like to introduce to you Jennifer Cave, principal at No Middle School. Please come forward to introduce your student.
It is my honor to introduce to you Alicia Leach from No Middle School. This distinguished eighth grader excels academically. She is driven, creative, well-organized, and self-motivated. Through her peer leadership, she tutors, mentors, and provides mediation to our fellow students. Please join me in recognizing Alicia Leach.
Board Vice Chair, will you please join them for a photograph? Thank you.
You might as well just stay up.
Next, I would like to introduce to you Tim Healy, principal at Brown School, to introduce his middle school student.
It's a pleasure for me this evening to introduce to you Kelsey Broyles, an eighth grade student at the Brown School. Kelsey, like the Brown School, many Brown School students came to us at an early age. She came to us in kindergarten, and then she left us for 1 year in third grade, but we didn't hold that against her. She saw the errors of her way, and she came back in fourth grade, and we've had her ever since. Kelsey is an advanced program student in our school. She excels academically, athletically, and artistically. She carries a 4.0 GPA and takes a double block of math at Brown in eighth grade, taking accelerated math and Algebra 1 as well. She's a published author. It was published in the Poet Power Fall Edition 2014. She's been featured in the Courier Journal Q Up column. She is a member of our varsity high school softball team, and she has a passion for visual art as well. She was a Scholastic's Gold Key winner this year with her mixed media entry just in the eighth grade. So it's a pleasure at this time for me to introduce Kelsey Broyles.
Next, Beverly Johnson, principal at Johnson Traditional Middle School.
Good evening. I have the distinct privilege and honor to introduce to you Cameron Kiesel. Cameron is an outstanding student at Lyman T. Johnson Traditional Middle School. He's attended there for the past 3 years. I remember on one occasion, I happened to be in a math class doing an observation, and I saw a twinkle in a student's eyes, and it was Cameron. He did an outstanding job explaining, using the manipulatives, and really teaching other students there in the classroom. And from that point on, I've always made eye contact with him in the hallways. He's always pleasant, friendly. He's extremely well-rounded. He's successful in the classroom, on the basketball court, and just a very well-rounded student. Cameron shared with me recently that he plans to attend Manuel High School. He says, if I don't go to Manuel, I would like to go to either Mail or Butler. His parents are strong supporters at Johnson. They're at our events, they're involved, and it has been indeed a pleasure to work with Cameron this past 3 years. Congratulations, Cameron.
Kim Rice, principal at Western Middle School for the Arts, please come forward to introduce your student.
Good evening. I have the distinct honor of introducing May Alice Harrell, who is an eighth grade student at Western Middle School. She has attended all 8 years as a vocal major. And if we had time, I would ask her to sing, but we don't have time. She is actually traveling tomorrow to attend the American Choral Directors Association National Conference in Salt Lake City, Utah, along with several other students. And this is her second time going while she's been a student at Western Middle School. Among this, she has many other achievements. She's received distinguished honors at Solo and Ensemble Festival for the past 2 years, and we know she will receive some more distinguished this year. She has been in many of our school-wide musicals. Most recently, she portrayed Grace Farrell in Annie. She is a member of the AP and Beta Club. She also has been accepted at Youth Performing Arts School. She has many academic honors. She has a very supportive family, but most of all, she's one of my favorite students, and I just love her. Thank you.
Now, Dr. Houston Barber, principal at the Academy at Shawnee, will introduce his middle and his high school student. Dr. Barber.
Good evening. I have the pleasure, distinct pleasure, of introducing two students this evening as a middle school and high school principal. From the middle school, it's Malia Spalding, and she is such an outstanding young woman. She enjoys reading, writing, math, but of course one of the things she's accelerating is in AP classes. And as we build our aerospace program, she's a part of that building that's going on. So it is my distinct pleasure to really tell you that this student is going to be sometime, I hope to see her up in space. If not, she'll be working in the STEM field. So Malia Spalding, congratulations. Also, I have one other student, Peyton Adelman. One of the things I want to share with you about him, he is looking to go to the Naval Academy, and he is working on his pilot's license, and so I hope to fly with him one day. I've been in a plane once with a student. I may do it again, but I will tell you his leadership at both as a peer leader and as a mentor for our students. His AP work and program work that he does there is accelerating, and just proud of him, Peyton Adelman. So congratulations, thank you.
Thank you.
I would like to ask at this time that Tim Healy, principal, if you will please come to the podium to introduce your high school student.
I'm back. It's a pleasure for me to introduce our high school student that I'd like to introduce to you this evening. Is a junior by the name of Stanford Loudon. Stanford came to us in the sixth grade and went through our middle school program, arrived as a typical sixth grade young man, that you might say, with a lot of potential, but in sixth grade you wonder just exactly how it's going to work out. And over the years, he has just gotten stronger and stronger and stronger as a leader and as a student, as a scholar, academic scholar, and an athlete. He currently carries a 3.9 GPA cumulative average, and last semester he averaged a 4.5. He's enrolled in AP Statistics, AP European History, Advanced Pre-Cal, as a starter on the basketball team. And he's also a published author as well. He was published in the Poet Power Fall Edition as well, and was a SPAVA Award winner when he was in middle school. So it's a pleasure for me to introduce you, Stanford Loudon.
Mr. Jerry Mays, principal at DuPont Manual High School, will you please come forward to introduce your high school student?
Thank you, Terry, and thank you, members of the board. It is indeed a pleasure when you have a school of 1,883 outstanding students to find a great one, and this young man certainly fits that bill. His name is Alexander Krenzel. Alex, would you stand up, please? I don't know if his mom, did Tiana make it here? Did she make it tonight? Okay. This young man's outstanding. I want to read a couple things that his counselor said, which really kind of fits all of it. So the first time I met him, I kept thinking there was no other student I knew that could possibly radiate more energy, enthusiasm for learning than this young man. I'll tell you just a little bit about this, a couple things real quickly. He came to us from a school that wasn't as rigorous as Manual, and within a few short months, and I don't know what this says about our curriculum, maybe we're not tough enough, I don't know what the deal is, but in 10 months, he finished years of computer science to get up to speed at Manual High School. Plays varsity soccer, is a tennis player, he's a concert master violinist, and I know Ms. Horn loves the arts, you love that, okay? He leads our ensemble. I had to jot down just a couple things, there's so many things, if you'll just bear with me real quickly. He is right now is in collaboration with another developer to do a healthcare application for an Android phone called Personal Medicine Plus. He has been flown to California by Google to use one of his apps on the International Space Station to assist in launch. I told Mr. Jones before tonight and Mr. Brady, I said, I got a guy for you two techies right away. Then Andrew be your guy, Alexander be your guy. Right now he's one of 60 students being courted in the country with an all expense paid trip to UC Berkeley for he and his family. He'll be going in what, 2 weeks or a week? Next weekend. I mean, the list could go on and on. He is our concertmaster for Y-Pass Philharmonic. He's a National Merit finalist. He's been awarded 2 Silver Keys. But the greatest thing about this and in all those accomplishments, all that pales to the character and the humility of this young man. And you'll not find a better one. I was telling somebody in the back, I have 4 adoptive daughters. If I were ever to adopt a son, this would be the guy. Alexander Krenzel.
We are so proud to now present the Performing Arts Schools and Magnet Programs in District 1 in a video montage. Tonight, we are so proud to have the opportunity to recognize February as Black History Month. The 2015 national theme is A Century of Black Life, History, and Culture, which highlights the great contributions made by African Americans in the making of American history. It also stresses the importance of African American struggles in striving for equality, opportunity, and racial democracy throughout our nation's history, as well as their role in making significant change in the lives of African Americans in the past, present, and future. Thank you. Joining us this evening is Ms. Dawn Lee, CEO for the WHAS Crusade for Children, who will present the Jefferson County Public School with a very generous grant. Since 1970, the district has received more than $9 million in grants from WHAS Crusade for Children, which have resulted in many incredible benefits to thousands of JCPS students with disabilities. Ms. Lee, will you please come forward to give your remarks?
Thank you. I am Dawn Lee with the WHAS Crusade for Children, and we are so proud of our long partnership with JCPS. And I feel somewhat inadequate standing here before you tonight because when it comes to the kids at Central High School, I can't answer any questions about your health or your blood pressure or your teeth. If you have legal questions, I'm out. Your business, even your pet. But what it did for me was serve as such a wonderful reminder that all the kids that were recognized and the ones that spoke, that JCPS is doing something right. So what a terrific partner to have. So thank you for what you're doing. We love to work with children who work different, who learn differently. And so this is our opportunity to continue that history. And tonight is that we want to officially present the check to the board for this school year, and it's in the amount, this year's grant was $181,692.32.
Ms. Lee and Mr. Larry Lefford, please come forward. If you'll join Dr. Hargens, Board Chair David Jones Jr., and district staff, Dr. Dewey Hensley, Dr. Michael Razor, Dr. Alicia Everett, Rick Capel, Becky Crump, and Terry Ray on the stage for this presentation. Thank you. Dr. Hargens and members of the Jefferson County Board of Education, this concludes our recognitions for this evening. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It is the traditional time now for us to invite the students and others who are here for the recognition portion to go ahead and go home, since we are going to have school tomorrow, right?
Yes.
Okay. But before you go, I just want to call out, it has been an extraordinary pleasure to hear from so many different students and teachers, principals in District 1, the range of activity, interest, and talent is extremely impressive. So we're very grateful to the hosts at Central High School for allowing us to be here, to Vice Chair Porter for helping us put this on, and it really is a deep pleasure to get to have some experience of all the wonderful things that are going on in District 1, so thank you. And now let's take a moment. Ms. Horn has made a request that we always stand up at least once every half an hour and stretch, right? It's good for us.
I'll go back and walk around our chair.
So I yesterday. That's right. Oh, okay then. Thank you. It's like a martial art, Brazilian martial art sort of thing. Yeah, I am so sore I can barely walk. Okay. We do. I neglected to ask for a motion to receive the recognitions. Mr. Brady moves. Vice Chair Porter seconds. All in favor, aye. Okay, that passes unanimously. We'll move on now to the regular board business. Is there a motion to approve the minutes of the previous meeting? Dr. Wilner, Mr. Brady seconds. All in favor, aye. Any opposed? That carries unanimously. And it's now my pleasure to ask Dr. Hargens to give us the superintendent's report.
Thanks, Chair Jones. It's my pleasure to call your attention to a few items of special interest. Strategic Priority 1.3 is about the importance of early learning interventions, pre-K through 3. So we worked on that at the work session. We know it's important to invest early on the front end. And again, we're pleased to be at Central High School because our mission is instruction that inspires students to learn, and that's happening here. I'm pleased to recognize in the audience Sam Corbett, who was unanimously hired by the Jefferson County Public Education Foundation Board as its new executive director. In this position, which is new for the foundation, Sam will serve as a key advocate of JCPS, working independently from the district, but working to harness community energy and resources to help JCPS fulfill its mission. We are grateful to have such a long-standing district ally and partner in this important role. Sam was most recently the Director of Community Engagement for the University of Louisville College of Education and Human Development. Would you stand, Sam, so we can recognize you? I'd also like to announce that Kristen Wingfeld will be joining Jefferson County Public Schools as the Coordinator of School Business Partnerships. In that role, she will facilitate relationships between a wide variety of stakeholders to ensure that JCPS curriculum and programs are aligned with the 21st century workforce needs of our region. Kristen will work to collaborate with our great business and community partners, including the work with Ford Next Generation Learning. And I know she'll build new ones as well. Welcome, Kristen, to JCPS. And Kristen was most recently the Vice President and Director of Education Initiatives and Campaign Partnerships at Fund for the Arts. I'd like to thank Mayor Greg Fisher and Metro Government for their collaboration and support during last week's bad weather. I'd also like to thank our own Dr. Razor and Director of Transportation Rick Capel for their work. I appreciate the collaboration between the Equity Office, John Marshall, and Nutrition Services. Our Director of Homeless Students, Giselle Danger Mikadaris, and Manager Dan Elnor put their heads together and delivered 5,665 meals, and we have pictures, valued at over $8,000 this past Friday before things expired. During the inclement weather day, students were encouraged to use Wonderopolis, an online site for engaged learning that's called the Wonder of the Day. An update on Louisville Linked, a systematic way to link resources and the needs of kids. 45,266 links were made through the fifth month, serving 150 schools and over 22,000 students. We want to recognize our 2014 Louisville Linked community heroes. Joe Autry from Home Depot, Polly Mayer and Gloria Mormon from Neighborhood Place, Paul Miller from KI Lumber, and Heather Wampler from 5th District PTA. Throughout the year, I've had the opportunity to present to the Focus Louisville cohorts. I ask them to forget everything that you think you know about JCPS. Listen to my overview and the progress of our wonderful teachers and principals, and then visit a school and make up their own mind about JCPS. This Focus Louisville group visited PRP, Frost Sixth Grade Academy, and Eisenhower Elementary. Here's a quote from one of the members of Focus Louisville that visited Eisenhower. "I just realized that I could have saved myself more than $15,000 by sending my children to Eisenhower, a public school, rather than a private school. You have resources here that other schools must be envious of, even private schools." While working with snowstorms in two states, JCPS staff and Tyler Technology staff continue to work to identify the discrepancies between our accounting system and the reporting platform. We call that the District Transparency Financial Transparency site. So we're tracking the differences to even smaller subsets, but have not found where the problem is. We're still off by millions of dollars, and I will keep you updated. Thank you, Chair Jones, and later in the agenda will be the consent calendar for your consideration.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Hargens. It certainly has been a busy 10 days or so. So thanks to everybody for all the hard work they put in to get the schools back open. Dr. Hargens, would you introduce the next item as well? We're moving into the action item section of the agenda. And if you could introduce the first one.
Absolutely. We're proud to be a district of innovation, and being a district of innovation gives us the opportunity to ask for waiver requests. So what Dr. Radowski is going to do is talk you through four waiver requests that really give us the flexibility that we need to increase student learning.
Hi there. Thank you, Dr. Hargens. Chairman Jones, board members, Dr. Hargens. In 2013, we became one of four school districts in Kentucky that was designated as a school district of like innovation. And since then, three other districts have joined this group. What a district of innovation really means is that we have the opportunity to look at the rules and regulations that like govern our like operation and basically ask the state for waivers from those rules and operations when we think that it might be an impediment to us becoming the best urban district in the country. And so tonight, what we are doing is we are asking for four waivers. Two are waivers for all the schools in our district, and two are waivers for the Catalpa program that will be at Maupin Elementary. So the first waiver has to do with like graduation. And basically what this waiver is, this will allow students to pursue their interest in their senior year if they are like eligible to do so. And so what does that mean? Well, we heard Dr. Withers tonight talk about the programs here at Central High School. And one of the things that he said was that if you want to be a lawyer, you have to know like language. So if one of the students that was in the like professional law magnet here at Central, if they were college ready in math, and if they had scored proficient on the end of course math test, then when they were a senior, they would not have to take the fourth year of math that is required for graduation in Kentucky, and they could go and pursue something in language. They could do something in writing, or they might do an internship, or they might do something else that could develop their skills and interest. And at the same time, if there was a student, let's say, that wanted to pursue something in like engineering, and you know, like at another school, and once again they qualified by being college and career ready, and they had scored proficient on all the end of course tests, then they could maybe waive a language credit or an extra credit, like one of the 22 credits in graduation, and basically pursue maybe a fifth or sixth math credit to basically get their interest in engineering. So that's the first waiver that we're asking for. And all the districts of like innovation, they are approaching their boards this month asking for approval of this waiver so that the Kentucky board can consider this waiver at their March meeting. The second waiver that we're asking for is a waiver around our English language learners. And basically what we are asking for is, we are asking for an accountability rule change in which if a student has not reached a certain level of proficiency in English as measured by the Access for ELS test, then the score would go to the district and not the school. Tonight we had several students that are at the like newcomer center. Basically, there's a lot of research that says it takes several years to become language ready. Unfortunately, the accountability rules say that after one year waiver, the accountability score has to go to the school. What we're saying is, let that score go to the district, and that it will be up to the district to provide research-based programs to get those students accelerated on their English language so that they can then be accountable to the school that they will be going to. The last two waivers have to do with the Catalpa school that will be at Maupin. Of course, this school was one of the schools that was selected in the competition that we had around the Districts of Innovation project. Basically, what we're asking for was in their proposal, and there are two waivers that have to do with instruction. Both of them come from a study of, and let me get it here, come from a group that is that basically has looked at the Kentucky core content and the Waldorf curriculum that will be at that school, and the first waiver talks about a sequencing change. All the students will still be expected to have the core content that all the other elementary students have in this district. It will just be sequenced differently than at the other schools. And the second waiver has to do with kindergarten students, in which they are asking for like some relief around, quote, the like rigorous academic standards that we are asking our kindergarten students to do, and basically that's the four waivers. So if you have any questions, I'll be happy to try to answer.
Okay, I think there probably will be some questions. Dr. Hargens, do you want to add anything before we go on?
No, that's fine.
Okay, are there any questions? Yeah,
Lisa. I just want to make a comment, about the Catalpa school. I just think it's odd that we have to request a waiver for a developmentally appropriate curriculum. It says that the Maupin Elementary will have kindergarten programs aligned with the age-appropriate developmental needs of students. And I, you know, it seems peculiar that we need a waiver for that. And then when you read a little further, what we're asking a waiver for is so that kindergarten children can have a rest period in the morning and then another rest period in the afternoon. And the reason they need a rest period is because the curriculum incorporates a lot of movement. So it's a wonderful approach. And I'm hoping that we'll be requesting waivers for more of our kindergarten programs in the future to have these kinds of
And I'd like to add like Mrs. Wilner, that if this works, you know, one of the things about the districts of innovation is that we've made a pact with each other that if it works, then we are going to try to bring what we have learned to the state level so that other districts will have the opportunity to do what we are trying to do.
I'm very, very excited about it. Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Hathaway, did you have a question?
I did, thank you. I'm just curious, am I? Curious about the timeline, the process from request to approval.
Well, what the timeline is that the first request, the one around high school graduation, people at the Kentucky Department of Education that have been involved with us with the districts of innovation, they wanted an approval from the seven boards of education around the graduation request, so that could go to the State Board of Education for approval in March. The other three requests, I think, will be reviewed by staff, and then if staff approves it, it will then go to the Board of Education at a subsequent meeting, and I hope it would be in April.
What's SAP?
What's that?
SAP.
Staff.
I'm sorry.
Approved by who?
Oh, by the Kentucky Board of Education.
Okay.
Staff.
It would have to be, yeah, it would have to be, it's my understanding that
no,
we
got,
have.
I thought it was an acronym.
Okay.
A new acronym. So.
Okay.
Okay.
I have one.
Okay. Chris?
My question regarding item number two. I appreciate the thinking of trying to have a more adequate reflection of what's going on in the school as far as achievement goes, especially when you're considering the significant challenges of English language learners. But my question is concerning when these results go to the district rather than being reported back to the school, is there any type of, I'm not sure how to phrase this, but any type of a situation where the district could be found as a priority district, you know, because if they were going to apply to a school, the school can be found as a focus school or priority school. Is there a way that type of accountability comes down to the district level if it's going to be applied to the district?
Okay. Well, first of all, the scores right now are in the district scores. Okay, if every school, you know, the scores really come up to the district. So what we're saying is, the scores will still be at the district level. It just won't be at a school that the student really might not have attended yet. Okay, right. So that's what we're asking for. And an answer to your question is, yes, there are provisions for the state to basically deal with low-performing school districts. Yes.
Okay. And I'm aware of that issue of tracking back students, especially because I've talked to some of the principals in my own district where a student will go there for maybe a week or two and then will be gone for the remainder of the school year. I mean, it can be a matter of months.
Right.
But yet, because they attended that school for that 1 or 2 week period, those scores are tracked back to that particular high school or middle school. But I appreciate the thinking out of the box. Well, not really necessarily out of the box per se. I'm sure this has been something that you've been thinking about for a long time, but I appreciate the effort in being able to have a more adequate reflection of what's going on in our schools.
Yep. We have worked with staff at KDE on the second request also, on the English language mm-hmm. learner request. And so we're very hopeful that we will get approval of staff that then it will be taken to the state board.
All right. Thank you.
Okay.
I'd like to just add onto that same second request, coming at the notion of putting the limited English proficiency scores at the district rather than in the schools. I would urge that we look at that as an opportunity in a different way. I had a conversation with a group called Greater Louisville International Professionals a couple of months ago. This is several thousand folks from all over the world who are working here in Louisville, and one of their pushes was, can we lay claim and can we prove that Louisville is the best place in America for a student who comes to the United States without speaking English to get their K-12 education. And I guess I would ask that you guys take a look. I'm not sure that any district claims that at the moment, which certainly means we could be either the best or the worst, whichever we chose. I would urge us to choose to be the best, but tracking that, as long as we're going to keep it centrally, I mean, let's see what we can do with it. We've got great programming already at Newcomer, and building on it would be wonderful.
Right. Sorry, I do agree with you, Mr. Jones, that that this is an opportunity for us,
it
and
is.
That our like limited English proficient staff is very excited about the opportunity to name and claim and do something different so that we can become the best district in regard to
other questions or comments? Yes.
Well, it's related to that. We talk about wanting to be the best urban district, and I just would want to add this into that measure of what we're coming up with as measures for saying, okay, we now are the best urban district.
Okay.
This might be one of those measures of that.
Okay. I will follow up on that, Mrs. Duncan.
Yeah, I want to pile on. That question came up in our orientation, new member orientation, and I think it was a very insightful question from Ms. Duncan. I mean, what's the target? Who's the best?
Okay.
I don't know exactly where it fits in the program, but we ought to nail that down and go for it. Other questions or comments about these waiver requests? I have one more then. You mentioned, Dr. Radosky, that with respect to waiver number one about if a student has already demonstrated mastery or proficiency or whatever the standard is, they don't have to take additional courses. And I think you said that was something that all the districts of innovation were asking for. Could you explain just, I mean, in short few words, I mean, what's the goal? Is it to free up time to do other creative stuff, or why do we want to take them out of the classes?
Okay, I think that part of it is, you know, we're still as an educational organization across the state, we are wedded to this thing called Carnegie Units. And I think that if you would talk to like researchers, that a lot of them would say that Carnegie Units are one of the things that get in the way of student interest. Okay, and so the idea is that if I am qualified for, you know, if I've qualified on the main goal, which is college readiness, and if I've demonstrated that I have skill, then why can't I, as a young adult, pursue something that I'm interested in prior to me getting out of high school? And maybe I can get another college credit, maybe I can get some kind of, some kind of opportunity that a Carnegie Unit might get in the way of, okay? And I think that that's what the thinking's about. You know, just flexibility for a student to pursue their interest.
Great, thank you. Are there any other questions? If not, I would entertain a motion to approve the four. Okay, Mr. Brady moves, Ms. Horn seconds, all in favor, aye. Passes unanimously. Thank you very much. Dr. Hargens, would you like to introduce the second action item?
Yes, you might recall from this budget, the 14-15 budget, that we put into the budget matching funds at $1.4 million to match the technology funding that we get from the state. But I thought it was important that not only accept the dollars, knowing that we're matching it, for Dr. Razor to give a brief overview of how do you follow those dollars into the classroom and into impacting JCPS.
Can you all hear me? Am I broadcasting?
I don't think so.
Am I broadcasting? Oh, there I am. Really, for the benefit of the new board members and a reminder for our veteran board members, we are given funds based upon our average daily attendance each year by the Kentucky Department of Education. In recent years, those numbers have been greatly reduced just to the Great Recession. We were 4 or 5 years ago receiving $25 a student. That amount fell to, for the last 2 years, to $16 a student, which greatly impacted two things most notably. A, the allocation we could give to schools, and B, our teacher computer replacement cycle. In order to basically stay afloat, we had to contract some of those. So basically, the way this works is we have a matching program with the state. This year, they're going to give us $24 per student. Right now, they've given us the first two of three installments on that. So I will be coming back to you sometime before the end of the summer with that third installment, which will be a $24 per student allocation that we will then match. So we're looking at around a $4 million total then when we include the match. $50,000 of that must pay for part of my salary or a member of our technology team's salary. That's a state mandate. We also use $165,000 of that money to fund two positions within computer education. These are our folks who help teachers use technology in the classroom and teach the staff how to use the various softwares and other technology that we have. Outside of that, we take $2 million right off the top, and we then divide that out to schools for them to use an allocation based upon their attendance. And then finally, what we do is we also, we also outlay $2 million for the teacher replacement of computers. That's also done. Then any money that's left over, we have a committee of district technology officials who decide what the needs of the district are, whether that be a new core for the data center, that be expanded wireless throughout the district, things for the greater network. Any questions?
Okay. Mr. Hathaway.
Thank you, Dr. Razor. I know I've had discussions with you about this funding, and there was concern when the state funding dropped, if there was some movement that we could keep our half or our percentage of that funding fairly consistent. How would you report we've done on that? Have we made it a priority? Has it been done? Or are we just following whatever they give us, we're matching?
Well, in the time since, I remember the conversation we had by that, this is now that next time, okay, and we're being fully funded again. Okay. The other thing that I did fail to mention is next year they estimate that we will be anywhere $27 to $29 a student, which then would be on the progression that we should have stayed on if the recession hadn't hit.
Two other questions, if I can. What is the targeted rotation for the teachers for replacing their laptops?
5 years.
5 years. Are we following that pretty well?
We are a little behind now, but since we've had this infusion of extra money, what we're hoping to do is replace 200 extra machines a year, and within 5 years we'll be back on the five-year rotation cycle completely.
And that's communicated to them as well?
It will be. We've now just received the funds.
Okay. And then maybe Jonathan, you could speak to this. Are we involved anywhere in our advocacy when this issue comes up in Frankfort about the CATS funding?
I know that the Department of Education last year, I'm not dancing around your story, they made a concerted effort and they showed the hurt that we were seeing in districts, and I participated in putting some data together for KDE to share with the legislators about how it was hurting districts.
So we're ready to jump in the tussle if need be?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Jonathan, did you want to add anything?
I would just add that 2016 will be a budget year, and that will be an opportunity for us to weigh in on any number of things, including funding for technology.
Good point. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Is there a motion on this item? Okay, Mr. Brady moves to approve. Mr. Hathaway seconds. All in favor, aye. Okay, passes unanimously. Okay, the next item on the action agenda is the review of the superintendent's contract. I would like to offer an introduction to kind of the background and the purpose of why we're here tonight. The board had a very productive and highly interactive work session from 5:30 to 6. And I will ask our general counsel, Rosemary Miller, to correct me if I bungle any of the technicalities. And apologize to everybody, it's a little bit dry in the beginning, but we actually have, once we pieced it together, a fair amount of procedure and state law and regulation that govern this issue, which I know to a number of members of the public seemed to just kind of spring out of nowhere. The background here is that, first of all, the current contract under which the district employs Dr. Hargens expires on June 30th of 2015. That will be the end of 4 years for her with the district. So the contract is expiring in about 4 months. Second, there is a rule, I believe it's Kentucky state law, that says in any election year, a board cannot consider the extension of a contract. So until the new board was sworn in on January 12th, the board couldn't really take up this matter. Next, there is a policy, a written policy of this board, that says as soon as practical, in the year in which a contract expires, the board must review the performance and decide what to do about the contract. So as soon as practical. And now it gets a little complex. That stuff is all kind of tried and true, but in 2012, the Attorney General kind of threw a curveball at school boards by ruling that in the closed session, which is the way school boards in Kentucky review on an interim basis the performance of a superintendent. We call it the formative assessment period, and it typically occurs in January. But during that closed board plus superintendent discussion, the Attorney General opined that we are not allowed to discuss the contract. So we have to discuss the contract in public. And I apologize for all that mumbo jumbo, but where we are is when we talk about performance, we're not allowed to talk about contract or compensation. And when we talk about contract, we're not allowed to talk about performance. So one of the things in the work session we sort of agreed to was let's ask Rosemary to see if there's not a way to get the Attorney General's office to review that. Enough with the procedure. The sense of the board in the formative assessment was quite strong that Dr. Hargens is our leader, that we are enthusiastic about her leadership, and that we believe that the district is going in a positive direction under her leadership. The contract that she has requested, or that she has told the board that she would be eager to sign to continue her leadership in this district, is one that I offer my reflection is particularly modest and self-effacing in this day and age of CEO compensation. Dr. Hargens has asked that there be no increase to her base salary. She has declined, and she's asked that we delete from the contract the automatic escalator clause that has, over the last 4 years, said that anytime teachers get a raise, she gets a raise. She has declined every time that has happened over the last 4 years to change her base compensation. So she's still at the same base salary that she was when she came here, and she's asked that that be deleted entirely. And in addition, she's asked that bunch of stuff related to technology support for the superintendent that differs from the technology support that other teachers and principals and everybody in the district be provided. She's asked that that be deleted so that she gets the same services and has the same dividing line between public cost and personal cost as the other professionals in the district. So it is my recommendation to the board that we agree to this contract and that we go forward to empower Dr. Hargens as our leader to continue the progress, and that we cheer her on and also turn up the heat and urge her to go faster. So that is my introduction, and I would entertain a motion or a comment. Is that a comment or a motion?
Comment.
Comment. Mr. Brady.
Actually, it's a little both. My concern about the way this has been brought about is that I think that we need to do due diligence regarding public and time of public comment. I think that the process by which we have done this is understandable by the way it's come about, but I also don't feel a pressing need to be able to do this right now. And I also know that given last week's weather issues, that the and also the fact that the general public may not be aware of when our agenda comes out on Wednesdays, and also I don't want to set precedent on fairly large issues that we talk about it in work session one day and then also pass on it later on that evening. And I do believe this is a very significant issue. Then my motion is that we table this particular item until the very next meeting. This is not in any way a reflection on Dr. Hargens, but this is a reflection on process and also a reflection on making sure that we have the or give the public the opportunity to be able to comment on this, which I believe is part of the one of the main duties or one of the main reasons why I am up here, is to be able to listen to the public and hear their concerns for or against. So that is my motion.
Okay. Is there a second? Okay, Stephanie seconds. Are there comments? Linda?
Well, I was going to make that motion, so I'm pleased to that Stephanie seconded that. So I do think we need just a little space in here.
Okay. I will say the same thing that I said in the work session, which is I think delay serves no purpose. The notion that this board has a tried and true practice of introducing something in a work session once and voting on it 2 weeks later is inaccurate, unfounded in practice. Our counsel confirmed that earlier. And I guess there are three reasons why I will vote against this motion. First of all, the board has completed its work in evaluating the superintendent for this cycle. That work is done. Second, although it sounds nice to say we will consult with the public, in fact, it is our responsibility to decide on the superintendent's employment and contract. And we are accountable for that, in my view. And delaying serves no purpose. There's no forum for consultation. There's nothing on the agenda for consultation. And third, we've got a lot of other work to do. So that's my view about this.
Can I ask a question?
Sorry, Ms. Horn.
I brought this up in the work session, and I'm going to just bring it up again. One of my deeply held values, and also it is in our GCPS Vision 2015, is that adults model accountability. And that is my desire, that as things change, they're not just going to stay the same. And one of the reasons I think we have a new board, we want to model that accountability by having some of these big issues, such as the budget, how we have it in a working session, and then in another meeting on a different day, we vote on the budget. This is one of the singular duties as a board member, is to appoint your superintendent. And I feel like a responsible board member, we had a great working session. I will say I do support Dr. Hargens 100%,
and I will be voting to have her serve a four-year term. That's not the point. I think the point is that there are other people in our community, our stakeholders, that also should be engaged in this discussion also. We've had snow, we've had, you know, people don't really, you know, we're kind of inside baseball here. To know that this even was coming up as an agenda item. So I just think as a community, I think that we should have this discussion. I think it is very unusual, as David, our chair, Mr. Jones, points out, that we are separating the performance from a contract. Legally, it's something that we're required to separate. And we hope to talk to our Attorney General and really get an opinion on this, because it just doesn't seem that it is right, is the right way to handle these issues. But as a just being trying to be a responsible board member, I do think that this is, you know, the right vote for me. Thank you.
Ms. Duncan?
Oh, I'd just like to ask Rosemary if she could comment on that statement that you made about we're at the end of the evaluation cycle. Does this mean that we do not need a summative evaluation in June?
I didn't understand the question.
I ask if our approval.
I don't think I said that you didn't need one. That's your choice to make. But that typically, what I explained was that the typical process for districts to go through is to do this consideration after the mid-year formative evaluation, and that is what your policy says. That's the timing that your policy gives for this.
But then, is the summative evaluation necessary in June?
No.
No. In this case, I think you have to look at the entire performance of the term as part of your review. So you're looking at previous summative evaluations. You're looking at a continual cycle, essentially, of review of performance. So I think that's what boards tend to base these decisions on, and not just the last summative evaluation of the term.
Ms. Porter.
Is this okay? I guess my comment is that when we did the formative evaluation in January, I believe that was the first board meeting when the new board members were sworn in. At that time, I do not recall that anyone said to us, and I guess it was my error that I did not check with General Counsel, but it seemed not appropriate to do that as we swear in four board members on the same night that we do the formative evaluation. In that conversation for that, there was absolute consensus that this district was, for once in a long time, going the right direction. I regret the fact that we're having this conversation in this manner, and maybe in the next 4 years, the Attorney General can fix it, because it took 5 months to get a simple question answered from the Attorney General. So I can only imagine how long this will take. So it appears that we don't, you know, that there is a difference of opinion. And I don't think that we should come together and talk about the work of the district. I'm not talking about a performance evaluation, and have to go away and think about it for 2 weeks, because I agree with Board Member Hadaway. People are gonna tell you what they wanna tell you when they see you, wherever they see you, whether it's at the Kroger, whether it's at the Starbucks, or wherever the case may be. So I think that we do not agree on this, and I don't understand the rationale for 2 more weeks. There has no, did someone sign up to speak about this tonight? Or do we have any speakers on this item? No one has signed up to speak. I have gotten not one email, not one phone call, and in the interest of professional integrity, I do not understand why we are waiting 2 weeks on this. Either you do it or you don't do it. And again, At the first meeting in January, the consensus was for every board member that the district was going in the right direction. We are not talking about performance summative. We are talking about the next step that we did not take the first meeting in January. So I do not agree that we should wait 2 weeks, so, and I guess we should just vote. That's the best way to get it done.
Yeah, I guess the only thing I would add for my colleagues' consideration is it's a competitive market for talent, and if you guys think it's fine to just wait, then we'll roll that way. So we have a motion and a second. All in favor? Okay. Opposed? Okay. Fails. I move the adoption of the contract as proposed. All in favor?
You needed a second. I second your
motion.
I'm
sorry. Diane seconds. All in favor?
Wait. Before you, can I make a comment before we vote?
Correct.
Because
please comment.
Yeah. First of all, I want to compliment Dr. Hargens for this past week and make all the decisions that were made in regard to the weather. And I also want to compliment Dr. Hargens for the progress that the district is making. That is not a question for me. The only question that I had in this was the length of this time period and whether we should be deciding this now or give it a couple of weeks and then decide. The length of the contract is the problem with me, because I think as long as there have been concerns expressed, it kind of gives us a chance to put a limit on and see if we can make progress in those areas of concern. So, that's the reason that I feel the way that I feel. And now, if you want to go ahead with your vote, that's my comment.
Okay. Any other comments? Okay. Moved, seconded, all in favor? Okay. Opposed? Okay. Motion carries 6-1. Thank you. And Dr. Hargens, thank you.
Thank you. Let me just say I appreciate the opportunity to serve 101,000 students is an incredible opportunity. So I believe I have the best job in Louisville, and I appreciate the commitment of this board and the support of this board. So thank you.
Great. I think it might be a good time to stand and stretch. Okay, we next move to item 7, which is the information item, the Board of Education discussion agenda planning calendar. I want to call everyone's attention to the fact that in the consent calendar, there is an item that will move this until the end of the meeting, beginning in the next meeting, so that we get our order appropriate. But other than that, are there any comments on the planning calendar? Yes, Chris.
Yes. On the last consent calendar that we had at our last meeting, I noticed that there was a work session for Vision 2020 Strategic Planning Meeting Number 1,
yep.
But it's not on this particular calendar. I wasn't sure of when that might be coming up, and I know that was mentioned earlier this evening.
Dr. Hargens.
And actually, we'll have to look at placing that back on the calendar, the Vision 2020. So we will definitely have that placed soon on the calendar.
Okay. Do we know, will that be within the next meeting or two? Because it's not actually in the calendar for the remainder of the year, as far as I saw.
Well, actually, it was planned actually for today, but we switched it to be able to have the work session for the superintendent's contract. So we will put it in the next, if not at the next meeting, the following meeting.
Great. Thank you.
Okay. Good call out. Yes, Linda.
I just had two things that I think need to appear on the calendar. One is the at the end of the legislative session, if we have a summary of how our agenda did. And also, I think in March, we're going to look at that Dr. Getz's proposal. So is that appropriate to try and go ahead and place it on the calendar? Because I hope we can get it in there by March.
Absolutely.
I think that's a good call. Yep.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, one more thing. When are we going to be planning on our retreat or planning session? And I know we have put that off from last year because we were expecting some at least one new board member, and we have
right.
two.
Yep.
So I wasn't sure when that might be placed sometime on a calendar.
We haven't discussed that since the new board formed, but it's an important topic.
And actually, it's typically happened in May or June.
Yep.
Planning session.
Yeah. Maybe we can do a doodle event to figure out when is the good time to get everybody together. But yeah. Typically, it has been May or June.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I think you know the we need to move on now to laying out the work plan for how we're going to put this Vision 2020 together. You know, we've got the work groups forming, and we'll come back and talk about them toward the end. But let's come back with a multi, that's better. So we'll have to put together a Vision 2020 planning calendar that will be probably one strategic retreat, May, June, and some early work sessions. Okay? Yes.
Are we going to get a facilitator? Is that kind of the plan, that we would have a facilitator for that?
That is the way we have worked in the board retreat or planning days in the past. So, okay, great. Is there a motion to accept the planning calendar? Okay, Linda and Chris, seconds. All in favor? Aye. Very good. We now have tie bids. Ms. Porter.
It's item number two for first aid supplies. Everything Medical LLC.
Okay. Great. Thank you. The next item is the consent calendar. Dr. Hargens earlier recommended the consent calendar for our consideration. Are there items that people would like to discuss? Okay. In the mic.
T.
T as in Tom.
Yes.
Okay. T as in Tom. All right. Others? Okay, then. Ms. Horn.
Okay, this is the part I had talked to Rosemary, and she said this fit in because this is addressing revision of a board policy. At the next meeting, because this is a special meeting, we can't add agenda items or anything like that. So I just have to introduce the topic today, and then hopefully we can have it on the agenda at the next meeting. The idea of having information items, we have an agenda item, it's called an information item, and then we also have the action items. My suggestion is to have, like many boards, a policy that items are presented as informational, so it's kind of like a new business, and then they're voted on in the next meeting. So you could have topics come up and be introduced, and then they come for a vote at the following meeting, such as we have a alternative school program that Dewey wants to tell us about at one meeting, so we're not, you know, it's so awkward for everybody in the community then to try to vote on it in that same meeting. There's been numerous examples of this that I've observed, so I think having a rule or a policy such as this would actually aid board governance. It would aid our staff in their presentation of items. So I will work with Rosemary, with Mrs. Miller, to formulate a simple policy that I would then like to just have it on the agenda at the next meeting. And she said this was the appropriate area to talk about this. Thank you.
Okay, so.
So no action or anything.
Okay, so that really is unrelated to T. It's just you're calling out your desire that the board adopt a sort of a two-step standard.
Just to try to get on the agenda at the next meeting.
Okay.
Yeah, that's it, simply.
Okay, great. All right, is there a motion to accept the consent calendar? Mr. Hadaway moves, Mr. Brady seconds, all in favor? Okay, thank you. I think we are now into board reports and requests. Who would like to begin with a report? Mr. Brady.
Thank you, Chair. First of all, I want to thank Diane Porter and also the staff and principal here at Central High School for hosting us this evening. It's been really great. I really appreciate it, the opportunity to be able to learn more about this great school and its rich history, as well as seeing some of the fantastic facilities like this great hall that we have here today. So I want to say thank you for, I know that there's a lot of hard work that she put into organizing this and pulling people together, and I want to say thank you. I really do appreciate that. My other item, doesn't necessarily relate to school boards as it does more of a community issue. And I'm kind of taking a point of personal privilege here. Kenny Winfield died this past week. And most of you don't know that name, but it might ring a bell because he was the homeless gentleman that died as a result of exposure. I talk about him right now, not because of the issue of homeless being outside or not knowing procedures or white flags or anything along those lines. I talk about him right now because in all the news reports and the comments I've seen on websites, they don't talk about him. I was his supervisor when I worked for another company, and I can tell you that he was kind, funny, dedicated, and a hard worker. I don't want that to get lost. And this is the only public way I can figure out how to get that into some record somewhere of knowing that this guy is not invisible. This guy had, you know, a life, had a personality, and under unfortunate circumstances, he lost his life in a way that should never have happened. But I just want to talk about him as a person and get that on the record and not just it being another statistic in our city. So thank you.
Thank you. Linda?
I just wanted to mention the fact that I visited Frost Sixth Grade Academy the other day because I'm down that way so much anyway, and a lot of my kids choose to go to Frost there. But the sixth grade program there is just such a refreshing, exciting thing to observe. And I know I spoke with the staff there, some of the security and custodial staff, and people who were not the classroom teachers, actually, but I know they brought up the fact that they would love to keep these kids because they've gone through a whole different training with under Dr. Stroud. It's a whole different attitude, a whole different atmosphere at there, and so I thought it was welcome news that they were thinking that they would like to keep those kids and just move them up to the second floor and bring a new crop in next year. I don't think we're thinking like that, and I don't think that's the direction really that we were headed, but I did want to relate the fact that they're so pleased with their programs out there right now that they even feel like that. So I think that's a great sign for the work that's been done at Frost.
Okay, thank you. Let's see, do we need to go to the other side for a moment, or? Can we keep working over here? Go ahead. All right.
I'll just mention.
I have my first community conversation on Tuesday, March 3rd at 6 o'clock at Newburg Middle School, and I would love to see lots of folks there. I was hoping to go to Mr. Brady's to get a nice example before mine, and it was snowed out. But I want to invite the community to that. I also want to thank the staff. I don't know who the report came from, but I had requested a report on the school resource officer program and got a very nice, thorough report, and I appreciated that. I learned some things, for example, that only 60% of our school resource officers are certified and have the recommended training. There are also a lot of differences among the different schools about how that SRO program is implemented. There's a lot of data that I'm interested in seeing that wasn't included in the report. For example, how much school time is lost when what should be maybe a school discipline problem becomes a court problem, and so the child is being disciplined both at school and in the court system. So I guess it was an excellent report. I learned a lot. I'm going to be bringing that back with some more questions. So I wanted to, I guess, just let you know I'll be doing my homework and bringing that back.
Great. Okay. Actually, let's jump over to Steph.
Yes, I will snow it out, and it's been rescheduled to March 31st. Thank you.
Actually, I was going to say, if you hadn't been snowed out, it's pretty normal. Mr. Brady would have shown that the crowd tonight that came out with Ms. Porter and the Valley crowd that Mr. Hadaway got together, that's what you should expect, right?
Absolutely.
Not quite. Okay. Steph.
Okay. We had received the report about the SRO officers. It was excellent. It was well prepared by Stan Mullins. And so I had contacted my schools, and we have one SRO in District 3, and it is shared by Westport and Camer, and it was not at their request. It was provided to them, and so they are very, very pleased with our SRO officer. He is excellent. He is a Louisville Metro Police Department employee. And he is tremendous. The feedback that I received is that it all depends on the person, a lot of it. There had been somebody, you know, in the past that wasn't a good fit. But this officer's been there for several years and is tremendous. We have in District 3 what are called security monitors. And they are extremely well received in we have them in Crosby Middle School, Camer Middle School, Westport, and Ballard and Eastern. Those are our middle through high schools. And we are very pleased with them, and they are not police officers. They are JCPS employees and trained by the district. So it is working well in District 3. So I also needed to do a little housekeeping. Being a new board member, I wasn't paying attention to some of the minutes, and I wanted to make sure, Rosemary, Ms. Miller had said this is the way to do it, that I had a few comments that I wanted to make sure got into the minutes. I can see that Dr. Hardens and her team are heeding the audit to align the budget with the audit recommendations, and I look forward to seeing this, you know, presented from Cordelia and her team. I'd like to see if we can change like the paradigm and have a sea change, because how can we ask our constituents to raise taxes if we haven't first reduced spending in other non-teaching learning areas? If we can please turn our attention, we have this great internal audit function now that I'm very excited to see what we'll be focused on potentially in purchasing and warehousing and consolidation of facilities. We had talked with Dr. Razor at the meeting at Valley about, I look forward to the report on 6 administrative office buildings being consolidated. Looking for other ways, David Jones, Mr. Jones, our chair, is leading the way with looking at operational, logistical, technological performance issues. So the bottom line is that our current system says limited funds demand choices be made. The question is whether our spending will reflect our values. I am very much personally looking toward funding, more funding for music and arts. I'm looking to make sure that we are funding instructors, adequate number of ESL instructors. In one of my schools, we have 87 ESL students, and we have two ESL instructors. So that would mean that each child would get about 45 minutes. So we have 21 music teachers for 87 elementary schools. Some of these music teachers are shared with the middle schools. So I really think that our values in the community of Louisville, if we can please focus, we have a culture of arts in this community. We need more teachers in our classrooms. I really look forward. I know Dr. Hargens, we had talked, is going to show us our ratios in all of our schools. And I'm really looking forward to that, to make sure we're funding our values and our budget reflects that we're trying to get more money to learning and to teaching. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Porter.
Thank you. First of all, as it pertains to board request, I would be interested or curious to know, as it pertains to funding for high school, for the last 3 years, I would like for the board to see the funding that has come to the high schools, particularly to schools like a Central High School that has a magnet program. So I would like to know the money that has come from the school to career office and from the district, because there has to be some consistency with programming and funding that goes into our schools, because all schools deserve the best. So for the last 3 years, I know that we get Carl Perkins money, but that's not the only money we get. So I'm interested in knowing money that has gone into individual programs, and we heard about multiple magnet programs tonight. Money that has gone for equipment or equipment replacement. I would like for the board to see what that looks like. Also, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the University of Louisville and the Yearlings Club for the community panel that Dr. Dewey Hensley and I served on at the Yearlings Club. Thank them for that opportunity to be there to talk about the Jefferson County Public Schools. I'd like to take a minute to thank the community leaders that came in tonight to have dinner with our fine students, and I cannot say enough how proud I am to be the District 1 School Board representative, and you saw just some of the wonderful students in this district and in the Jefferson County Public Schools. One of the things that I must mention, there have been many famous people that have walked the halls of Central High School, and if somebody's new to town and hadn't, you know, been around lately, Muhammad Ali was one of those people that walked the halls of Central High School. But there are many famous, bright, brilliant people. And I'm bringing that up because last night I heard someone, or maybe today, give an acceptance speech. And he said, when I was growing up, I thought I was weird. I thought there was something wrong with me and that I was strange, and I almost gave up on myself. And what I would say to us is that we can never give up on our kids, because they all have gifts, and it's our job to find the gifts and to nourish them. So thank you for coming to District 1. I'm still excited about it, but it was a great opportunity for you to see some of the finest, so thank you for this opportunity.
I think we should have one more round of applause for Ms. Porter. And I just want to add my thanks to the Central community for hosting us. I do have a couple of nerdy items to finish on. Ms. Horn called out the new organization of internal audit, and I think we may have an open request from the internal auditor to name a contact person or something like that, and I just want to flag that so we don't lose it. Let's make sure we come back and figure out what we're going to do about that. And then I also just want to mention the working groups that we've talked about of the board. This came up in the work session about early childhood education. They are getting started. Dr. Hargens, we're gonna need a little more probably specificity about who's staffing what, but I believe Chris, you and Steph are getting organized with Teresa Reno Weber to come and talk about data and Next week. Okay, great. And then policy and pedagogy has
March 3rd.
And Mr. Hathaway, you got a date? No date. Okay. All right. But we're getting rolling. So I just wanted to flag that. I think this has been a wonderful meeting. We have one speaker on a non-agenda item, Mr. Mertis Strong. Mr. Strong, are you here?
Yes.
Okay, come on down, and I will read to you the rules that apply to each speaker. Each speaker is allowed 3 minutes to address the board. At the end of 2.5 minutes, a bell will sound once, and that is your signal that you got 30 seconds left. At the end of that, the bell sounds twice, meaning that your 3 minutes is up. So we thank you for being with us tonight.
Yeah, thank you. 50 years ago, I was looking forward to graduating from this place. And it looks the same. But what I want to say is I was making a cake. And the cake required a stick of butter. So I set the stick of butter aside. And I fixed the cake. And when the cake came out, I had forgotten to put the butter in. And I said, hey, it looks good. But when I ate it, it tasted like it had rocks in it, because I had left a main ingredient out of the cake. And I think we owe our children an apology, especially those of us who call ourselves Christian. You know, I see people talking about the lawyers and the doctors and, you know, how smart people are, but sometimes I wonder, are we as smart as we think we are? And I think until we get Jesus Christ back into the public school system here locally, and I'm not talking about legislation, I'm not talking about those guys down there, because we'll deal with them later. But these children, our children, need the privilege to be able to put a I Love You Jesus t-shirt on in the classroom. Our children need the privilege and the opportunity to know that they have a God, and the God made them to be who they are. Now, as old and ugly as I might look, I wouldn't trade my place for nobody on the planet Earth, because I'm very happy being who I am through my knowledge of Jesus Christ, my Lord and my Savior. And I know you guys, I know that you all have a relationship with God that our children need to share in on. Our children need to do this. We need to stop being politically correct. We need to allow Jesus Christ back in the classroom. And it's going to happen. It's duty bound to happen, because was that my... What's that, 2.5?
30 seconds.
Was that 3? 3? I always sit down when it's 3, because, you know, when you know you're right, you don't have any pressure. I got zero anxiety bringing Jesus Christ back to the classroom. And I want to make a distinction here. I didn't say we're going to pray in school. You did that when you had the brief moment of silence. But you pledged allegiance to the flag. You did that verbally.
Thank you, Mr. Strong.
Thank you. You all have a great day.
Okay. There are no other speakers this evening, and there is no need for an executive session, so I would entertain a motion to adjourn. Mr. Brady, Ms. Porter, seconds. All in favor? Okay. Aye. We're done. Thank you. Thank you, everybody, and thank you, Central, again. Oh.